Hey, everybody. I'm going to show you some interesting information today. Number one, look, this one is for any of you out there that are here to make a lot of money, period. That's the attitude that I came to the conclusion of when I was, you know, making this, going to make this video, and then also looking at what I was doing and have been doing the last few weeks, in particular with my accumulation of giga metals. Now, giga is an interesting situation because if you look actually back to, we got involved right here. I think that was an initial move. So that's 20, 30 months ago, right in this area. That's where we started buying it, elite premium members in the market. And it might've even been back here where we were accumulating. And that's why, you know, we need time on these illiquid stocks for bigger investors to get a position. Then we had a move, a big one into the 50s from 20, 22 cents, 25 cents is where it was recommended to premium members. So we had a double, but it fizzled after that. And we came all the way back down. And, you know, I was very involved here. You know, we had this layoff period where it wasn't really a focus. And then all of a sudden, we came into the March 2020 flush across the board in the markets. And what did I choose to do? I chose to zero in on, besides the larger entities, like, you know, buying call options on SLV and, you know, some of the bigger players that were squashed as well, even GDXJ options and leaps and things like that on the call side. I look at Giga and I'm thinking to myself, time to, you know, basically back up the truck a bit here. And so what happened there was we got back involved right all in here. I was nibbling, recommended it to folks. Very few people acted, you know, because the markets were just so scary and bloody. And I just so happened this time around, you know, I had some cash. And the reason for having some cash is by changing my ways after years and years and years of making the same mistakes over and over and over again that caused me to be in positions where when a market got destroyed and my own, you know, net worth, which at some cases was not so much, that getting, you know, 60% or halved in a week or two or three, when you've got, you know, that's your stash and you're scared, you get this feeling in your stomach. That's where a lot of people puke out. Now, I didn't puke out then, but I was trying to scrape up many times to just hold what I had, or just to nibble a little bit on a couple with some liquidity that I might've had from income. This time was different. You know, I go back a few years ago and I made a choice to essentially start where I was. And that meant that, you know, when income really came in and, or I had a hit in one of our, you know, juniors, which we've had many that we financed, it came free trading, we had warrants, it was up 10X. Instead of just continuing to roll into the same sector and the other high risk plays to duplicate it, I took a good chunk of that and I put it into cash. And not all of it was just into the bank, but a good amount of it was. And I just did that consistently. And then by the time that we had this 2020 route, I watched my accounts go down and I actually knew, because I realized too that a lot of people get freaked out fairly quickly, and, you know, doesn't have to be a level of, you know, just getting a red zone of blood like it takes for me to get those emotions and that feeling in your stomach, simply because, you know, I've been doing this since I was 20. I was a Series 7 broker before my 20th birthday. And I still recall the first real market correction when I had any stock on the books and any clients. And I might have had 15 clients. And we had maybe three different stocks that I was building positions in. Maybe I had, 15 to 20 clients. So it wasn't a lot, but it was something. You know, I had maybe like 500,000 under management. I mean, it was early days. probably when I was 21, I think, you know, something like that, 96, probably. But I remember, you know, one of the companies we had was Laser Vision Centers, and that one, I'd been opening accounts on it, and it was, you know, 17, 18, whatever. And it was one of the more developmental stage deals, ended up being a huge success. But I remember, you know, that was, I think, my biggest position at the time, a couple hundred, few hundred grand between my clients. I didn't own shit because I just was trying to survive. In fact, I think I was waiting tables at, I forgot the name of the restaurant chain, but anyway, to try to pay my bills, but and survive. But in any event, that day, it was just a real market correction, a real one. It wasn't a crash. And these things went down by 30% or something in 2 days. And I just, I remember I got sick. I felt like I was developing an ulcer on top of the usual stress, but I was a young guy and it shouldn't necessarily be happening. But I'm going back to those feelings of how much that affected me and how quickly, you know, when you see this stuff, like it can just turn you upside down from either greed or normalcy to just utter terror, you know, fight or flee, you know, like you're just getting out of there. You want to save what you have or it's going to zero. But in any event, I learned and I've practiced being a steel trap and complete mutant emotionally when I'm making decisions in the market. It's really a more of a rational game to me. 90% of the time, 80% of the time, because I actually thrive now in these extreme markets. Meaning, like, look at that March 2020. Go back into your emails and search what you got from me at, around March and April of that year. And you'll find that the bets that were made were very close to the bottoms in, you know, the gold miners and gold and silver. And, you know, I essentially was able to do that in spite of, yeah, I mean, I was still watching a big degree of my stuff getting smoked. And finally, what ended up happening, and this is why self-awareness for me has been a big, big deal in my investment results. And that is because I started to feel like the pit coming up, you know, and I was like, whoa, you know, my account in one of them was like, I don't know, it was down like 60% and like these junior gold miners, I think it was 50 to 60% and in a quick period of time. And finally, I started to go, wait a second. And this was a new thing, the pandemic and a new thing, but it's not a new thing. Nothing is a new thing under the sun. But in any event, it's just masked as a different story. But I looked at it and the thing that is never changing is human psychology. And that's why the markets are so fascinating to me. And essentially, when I felt that, as well as the confirmation of getting emails, texts, phone calls, right, it always happens right towards the bottom. The activity goes up right towards the tops, the pats on the back, the, oh my God, I'm up this. Should I buy it? At the tops. And at the other end of it, it's fear and selling. And so the newsletter has been a big gift for me in terms of a consensus extreme. And on top of that, when I got the belly butterflies, I actually was able to just completely act against opposite that, you know, opposite the feelings that I went and I started to buy. Now, not, you know, everything across the board all in, you know, but I was getting in there and I was picking and choosing what I was going to buy. And I had my catcher's mitt on and those purchases made me a tremendous amount of money over this period of time, which you'll see like with Giga, you know, this thing, we were buying it at 16, 17, 18, 19. And over here we were getting in, you know, it was like in the mid 20s, mostly. That thing just exploded on some news about Tesla, went to 244 Canadian. So you're talking about a 15 bagger from those purchases, not a lot trading though. But in any event, look what we have now. Okay. We have right now a situation on the weekly. I love the way this stock has been acting and it's in the face of a nickel market that has been acting exactly like I want to see it as well. And that's what I've kind of gone back to in some of these different plays is that, yes, I know the fundamental story. That's got to be intact, number one. Number two, I absolutely look at the technicals to give me guidance and indication on when to do what. But number three actually has gone almost to number one, I think, which is that in the early days, we didn't have all this stuff. We sat in front as a group at my first real, I would call it real firm, because I was at I was recruited out of college by a Wolf of Wall Street, Stratton Belmont spinoff run by the mob in Chicago. And they had what was it? One Quotron for a bullpen of, like, must have been 40 to 60 guys that were on the phone. So, like, obviously they were concerned about smiling and dialing, not checking your charts for clients. But in any event, this, even back then, 95, 96, 97, 98, the chart started to change around 98. But in any event, I had to feel it. I had to watch. I would watch. It's called tape watching, you know, reading the tape. Just like Jesse Livermore back in the day in the bucket shops, you know, he would watch how things were acting. And I did that too. And I still do that. And what's gotten my attention, because many times when we're focused on gold and silver, I don't really want to get too much of an allocation into the regular base metals. Okay. But nickel is very special, and copper has gotten my attention in the same way. And I'll bring those prices and charts up in a moment. But what you've seen is, actually, I'll do it right now because it is important to look about the overall, like, let's just look at copper first, because, you know, we are seeing real inflation start to pop up. It's always been there, but they can't even hide it anymore. It's going to be very interesting going forward. But I mean, look at this bad boy. That was the capitulation down here in the low twos. And this move by what is also forming a cup and handle formation. Yep. That's going to be very, very interesting here, because it is going higher. Okay. And the way that it has been acting after those big gains is exactly what you want to see. And on a monthly, we've got a bull flag forming. So it's going to probably pop. And the fact that this nor gold or nickel has come back really that much and is stabilized, that's a very bullish sign for me. And if you look at the monthly, so we've already broken the 19 high, okay, a few times, and we're still testing above it or around it right now in the eights. And then here's the weekly. I mean, you're looking at, this has been a rising market in nickel. This is just the sub-index in series AJJM. But it just shows the action since that 2020, similar to copper, but you've had a rising market. Now, what has Giga done? And that is, you know, you've had a rising market going into early 21, and Giga participated a little, but then it came all the way back down because it was way overbought on a rumor. So all the people that jumped and dove in and got sucked in have been puking this thing out and dribbling it out all through 2021, when their hopes and their dreams were squashed and squandered, and they said, I got to puke, so I have to sell. So that's pressure came on. And then right here, I thought it was very interesting that we hit in May of this year, we hit these mid-low 30s, and all of a sudden the decline stopped. It just stuck there and the volume dried up. Then we had a little, you know, little test move that wasn't quite ready. And then now we've had continuing 200-week moving average support here, guys. Giga, not to mention with one of the largest undeveloped nickel assets on the globe that could be really a clean ESG-focused deposit for a clean company like Tesla. It's no joke what this valuation should be at $8. I just did a review on the numbers on the PEA about a week, 2 weeks ago, and I don't have them off the top of my head, but you certainly can go to the website and get all those numbers. This stock and this company is so undervalued because people are not taking into the equation. There's no nickel coming online, and the nickel demand from just the EV growth. I mean, we're just talking about like a trend, okay? We're talking about an adoptive trend that is consistent and being penetrated in the market And it's clear now, you know, that this is where things are going. But guess what? A lot of those clean metals that run the show there, the problem that they're going to have, which is going to be, you want to know, you know, FOMO, fear of missing out, that's going to happen to the car manufacturers. That's going to happen to everybody that is relying. I mean, copper is a massive market. Nickel, cobalt, lithium, you know, all of these, it's you still have to watch out that you're not buying into big moves and hype and emotion. Giga right here, this thing is has been basing for how long? May 21. Now you got October, 6 months of pure basing after this steady decline and a high that was hit as a peak in September 2020. A year of just consistent downtrend selling. Then the buyers stepped in, the selling stopped. What happens next? The buyers buying is not going to find any stock at these levels all of a sudden. And then you're going to go higher. And I think Giga, when you're looking at the potential partners, buyers, suitors of production, helping take a mine of this size into production, you know, Giga's in the catbird seat because you didn't have people drilling for these new deposits in nickel for 20 years, for 15 to 20 years. I mean, you had much of this happen after we got a bull market going in the metals in like 01, 02. Before that, they've been sitting around for 20 years, you know, people chipping away, but you can't just flip a switch and produce metals. That's the thing. And they need supply to run their businesses and to be able to go ahead and actually capitalize on the growth. It's going to be like the mining sector right now in the sense that who can get a drill in Nevada? These companies have been put on ice for 6 months because there's no crews or drills because of the cyclicality. How about you have no material to build a car or anything that you want to build? That's a problem. So we're seeing activity pick up organically right now because you are starting to, a lot of these big companies are getting a whiff. They were looking for a while. Now they're ready to do something because they have to. So, you know, if this thing moves forward in terms of the financing of building a mine, watch out. I think Giga's first stop somewhere up here. What is that? You know, it's going to go on this trend line. $7 to $10 is possible on Giga. I don't know the timeline. I don't know the timeline, but I think it could be within like, you know, 12 to 24 months. That's a big return. That's a 20, you know, 10 to 20X. And the sky is the limit. You know, when we go above $10 nickel and if, God forbid, it goes in the teens, do you know what that does to the economics of a mine like Turnigan? Forget about it. But guys, the thing that I've always tried to remind myself of is you got to take action before all this starts to become clear to everybody else. That's why they call it risk. But risk is automatically correlated to reward levels, right? And so what I'm looking at, I don't see a lot of risk here on the downside. Yeah, a market meltdown that just crashes the universe, of course. Maybe not, though. I mean, this is very low downside and massive upside. It's an ironic, unique situation at this time. I would buy it up to 45 to, you know, 47 cents Canadian all day. And then chill out. Don't chase this thing to infinity right now, but get a part of a starter position on if you agree, if you think it's a good idea. And then, you know, when it cools off, and I haven't mentioned it in, you know, weeks, or it's, you know, nickel's having a pullback, that's when you buy more. You don't just give up. You want to change your life. You want to change your AUM number. If you're a pro, you got to wait and you got to do things correctly. And I'm only saying this because I'm actually qualified. Those of you that have been with me have watched me, you know, not all disclosed, obviously, but I've gone from, you know, the little guy to the big guy. And it's from decisions like this. Okay. That's what does it, but it's not going to happen overnight. In any event, I also want to give you a little taste. So Giga is a favorite idea. Now let's go over to my baby, my biggest position, the most money that I've put into a junior miner, and that is, well, let's save the Dave talk for, let's go right to a chart here. Oh.